edition.
When we say after hours, we mean many, many hours after.
Hours, yes. Sorry. Not only am I holding cheese, we've been sitting on the set for however many hours.
Yes.
Had not eaten.
Right. And she's been here many more hours than I have. She got here at probably like, what, 4 a.m. last night?
Yeah, basically.
Pretty much, because she had some Wi-Fi issues at home. Let's not get into that. But she's here now, still at 2:20 a.m. Eastern. Our broadcast just finished up, what, 5 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago?
Just about.
Okay, and we told you on the Twitter that
I'm going to tweet this, too, because I forgot.
She forgot. But first of all, we just sat through, I thought, maybe one of the best speeches of his campaign, and he had to win to give it. What's up with that?
Wow, well, I don't really want to play pundit. Not one of the best speeches of his campaign.
Really?
But here's what I thought about it. Jeff Brown and I
maybe
were talking.
Maybe it's because it's so late and we wanted this to be over and go to sleep. We thought it was the best.
It felt a little grandiose to me.
Right.
Especially the beginning of it. And then Jeff and I were talking about it, and it was really a matter of this could be the last big speech he has a giant audience for. I'm sure people will tune in for his inauguration speech, but he's not going to give another one of these again until he's the former president speaking at the Democratic National Convention, whatever year that is. And it just signaled to me he's thinking about his legacy. He's trying to set up the next 4 years, and it's just not that easy. When you look at all of these races up and down the ballot, this is still a very divided country, still a very divided government. He has an enormous task ahead of him, and he can talk a lot about forging compromise, but a lot of the rhetoric, I mean, he even repeated a line from his 2004 convention speech. It's the same sort of thing we've been hearing from him. All work together. We're not just red states and blue states. Actually, he proved tonight you exactly are red states and blue states. I mean, you have the map up right there.
Yeah.
All of that said,
the map on the Map Center, shameless plug.
Pretty momentous night. And it was just fascinating to see. One of the things we talked about at the very end of the broadcast was that Mitt Romney was streaming the president's victory speech on his website. And it was just the overwhelming word everybody kept using was classy. It was a classy move. He also posted on Facebook just a giant picture of himself saying thank you with a wave. And that's the sort of thing that Democrats and Republicans could come together on, and I have no doubt he'll accept the president's invitation to sit down with him. And then the big question is, what's next?
Right.
What does Congress do about everything else?
Okay, so a few of the questions that we have so far from Karen Daniel: how come our vote does not count?
What state are you in, Karen Daniel?
Exactly, I don't know. Colleen, can you look up the whole Karen Daniel history?
I can say, you and I both have lived in California. California is a difficult state to be from.
To count.
Not just to count, but also
it's a great state.
It's been taken for granted that it's a Democratic state for a long time. But don't forget, this is a state Ronald Reagan won. Richard Nixon won it. I mean, this is, there are Republicans that win in California. Obviously, Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger had sort of a coalition that ultimately faded away. But the bigger question is is the Electoral College really the best way to elect presidents? And at the beginning of the night, Mark Shields and David Brooks were addressing this question, and David said,
Oklahoma.
Unfortunately. But actually, this goes to David's point. What David said was he likes the Electoral College because he feels like it forces the candidates to moderate and to speak to a majority of the country by going to these small Midwestern states where they can actually meet people. And Oklahoma, it wouldn't shock me if someday that could ever have enough change or enough of the right mix of politics to matter. Let's say they started to hold a first in the nation caucus. Well, that would create a whole
David's argument is that we'd be basically looking at campaigns that cater to New York, California, to help
running up their
else.
Base. Exactly.
Right. Okay. Chris Hundall asks, I'm trying to find out how much popular vote went to Gary Johnson, libertarian candidate. Also, which states have the highest third party percentages for president? I don't know. We
you
could probably find out on our map
check
center.
That on the Vote 2012 Map Center right under us in the box. But the last one that I was looking at had Gary Johnson at about 1%, a little bit less than 1% in some states. The states where we were really looking
one
at
million,
this
1 million votes, 1% Gary Johnson.
And Virgil Goode only ended up with 105,000, less than, it's not even showing as a
0%.
And Gary Johnson, we were looking at him particularly in Colorado, where there was an initiative to legalize recreational marijuana.
Yeah.
And that was an area where they thought they could do better. Also, people that were just frustrated with this election wanted to cast protest votes. Gary Johnson even said, throw your vote away on me.
Yeah.
There was a lot of that. And that was when I was looking at some of the projections I made ahead of voting today.
What a coincidence. I happen to have that right here.
Did you steal that from my office?
I could have borrowed it from an office.
How did I do?
Was,
This is the Washington Post Outlook section. They do a crystal ball contest. I'm only on top because my last name starts with a B.
Totally biased.
You said
Obama with 290 electoral votes. And
he ended up with 303.
He's already got 303. Yeah. We don't know the results for Florida.
I had Massachusetts. I had them winning. I don't know what popular vote percentages were.
Warren
winning. Warren winning. I had Tim Kaine winning. I had Claire McCaskill winning. And then my Virginia vote total was 50.5 for the president, 47.5 for Romney. So we'll see if that ends up being close.
Okay,
and then I did a House projection. We have no idea what those totals are yet. It could be days and days.
What about House? Senate,
we've still got outstanding races. And actually, I'm sure hopefully everybody's keeping an eye on these for us so we can mention them if the AP calls something. But the big ones, Montana. This is the closest Senate race in the country right now. It's been a toss-up from the very beginning. In 2006, everybody went to bed on election night not knowing what the result was.
Yep.
Congressman Denny Rehberg has always been running strong there, but the last time we looked at results, we actually had him trailing Senator Tester by a good number. So there weren't that many precincts reporting. And then the other one is North Dakota, which is just such a fascinating race because this is a state that, by all indications, would be red. It was called for Mitt Romney very early in the night. But Heidi Heitkamp is a good candidate. The Democrats were confident about her from the beginning, and she ran just a good race. And she has kept this basically even and was running a little bit ahead of Rick Berg, a freshman congressman who's been running statewide in North Dakota just for one cycle. So this is a really fascinating race. If she wins, she'd be the first female senator from North Dakota and obviously would add another woman to the ranks of the Senate, which we've been talking about all night. So anyway, these two races, very big, very interesting.
Yes. You know, in the prognostication category, I would have to say the giant winner, I think 50 for 50 states, Nate Silver.
Nate Silver.
He's got a book out. I think he sold a few extra copies tonight because clearly in the last week or 2 weeks, there's a bit of tension on, is the fix in, so to speak.
Is he a wizard?
Not Crystal Lizard, that's a different
thing. Right. There's all kinds of internet memes about Nate Silver. And what he does is he takes these statistic models, similar almost to sports modeling.
Yep.
And he was able to project that the president had, I think last night, the last one, it was like 90-something percent chance of winning re-election. Well, he was right, but also the states that he looked at was right. And that's a compilation of polls. It's also looking at data on the ground. And he did well for it. And he we'll see if he's doing any humble bragging.
Yes. I don't think he has to be that humble about it. I mean, frankly, you rocked it. All right. Inane Musings asks NewsHour, Ari, Sibyl, and Tony, if you drop matchsticks on the ground, would Mark Shields immediately tell you how many there are?
That's a great question. That is referring, of course, to Mark being
wizardry.
Able to calculate the difference between candidates all night long. It's been a long,
there's a lot of subtraction
cycle.
That happened on the fly.
Not a lot of rest around here, so we were not that great with our math, but Mark was on top of it. And by the way, you're going to be able to watch that whole thing if you want to relive the night online.
Right. Motherload Beth asks NewsHour, blah, blah, blah. I want to know if you PBS folks will hold Obama's feet to the fire per all the promises he made tonight. I think we're going to try to keep doing our job like we have done our job.
Well,
so.
And we're already thinking about what we're going to do on the show tomorrow night. This is obviously going to be 6 p.m. Eastern time.
That's actually later today.
Yeah, good point. besides just general analysis of who voted, what it tells us about the country, but what will the president do? He specifically mentioned immigration in his speech tonight. This is something that
he mentioned climate for the second time, I think, in the campaign. Once was at the conventions when he said climate change is not a hoax, and then tonight something about leaving a world for our children in better shape or something.
Sounds pretty bland, not like a promise of actual legislation, I would say. But he did say in an interview with the Des Moines Register that he thought was off the record, later became on the record, that he wanted to pursue comprehensive immigration reform in a second term. What's interesting is the types of Republicans who were elected tonight, the types of Democrats who were elected tonight. It's possible you could see some sort of consensus, but the first thing they're going to have to deal with, and this is something we'll be addressing at length on the NewsHour over
at
the next
length.
Few weeks, is this fiscal cliff issue. You've got sequestration, a lot of big budget cuts happening, but also, what do you do about the tax hikes? President Obama ran his campaign on, I will let the tax increases, the tax cuts
for the
wealthiest
expire. Right.
Democrats have been saying for a long time they would go along with that, but let's see if they actually have to vote on it,
right.
What happens.
Okay, she has a phone call scheduled in 1 minute, so we're going to let her go. However, not before we say Mr. Boonstra, you guys are troopers. You said that. Yes, we are. Playing with Dust, who apparently is drinking his morning coffee in London. He loves the internet. We love you.
Yes.
And
we do love you.
Dave Gustafson wants to have a serious conversation about Citizens United, but Dave, you used to work here, and we're not going to do that for you.
Although, I will say, we will be taking a look at how did super PACs really make an influence here? Yes. You know, Montana is an example we could talk about. Virginia, where you had outside spending from these Republican groups that Democrats were complaining about for months and months and months and months. These Democrats all won tonight. Even Claire McCaskill, in a very, very competitive race in Missouri, where they spent millions of dollars against her, was able to be reelected.
And there were, I think, four states that had gay marriage on the ballot.
Yes, right? This passed. Is huge. This is huge. There was one state that would have banned it, and that failed, and then the other three.
Okay, the ban failed,
it.
And then the other three went forward. And then marijuana was also on some ballots.
I have not looked at how that did. But the marriage initiative is amazing, and I've seen a lot of different social media discussion about this because you've got your first openly lesbian senator, Tammy Baldwin, who won in Wisconsin. And at the same time, four states basically say marriage is okay. Maine and Maryland, strongest votes there. And this is the first time voters have actually made this decision. You've seen state legislatures do it. You've seen executives, you know, from San Francisco Mayor Gavin Newsom or then Mayor Gavin Newsom do
it. When it's put to a vote.
But this is an actual vote, and it says something about demographic change, which really is what the night was all about.
Or the Pentagon, for example. I mean, don't ask, don't tell, repealing that. I mean, basically, that there are military commissions that have studied this and said that population is in a different place than it was when these laws were instituted.
It's a changing country, and that's something we're going to take a very close look at.
So we will take a look at all of the winners and the losers and the ballot measures and all the state races, or at least which ones have been decided by tomorrow or later today, afternoon, evening.
And we also will be thanking the amazing and tireless staff. It seems like 5 years ago that I was sitting here this morning kicking this off, and Justin was sitting in that same exact spot, and Josh was sitting in that
same
exact spot. And I just, you guys are such troopers and so amazing. Colleen, you're awesome. Everybody in the newsroom working so hard and just keeping everything great. So grateful. And all the people who made the show really awesome tonight. So this is like a huge team effort. It's so great. And we're so grateful to everybody for staying with us
Her
all day
eyes
and all
are
night.
Burnt red. Thanks. Because she actually just had to take the contacts. Everybody there's thinking about it. And they're saying, why isn't she talking about the marijuana issue? Just look at her eyes. But I'm telling you, it's because she took her contacts out. That's how real we're keeping it here on the late, late, super late.
This is true. I did not finish eating the cheese I wanted to finish, however.
So she's going to go off camera now, eat the cheese, make some phone calls, probably crash on a couch at the news hour so she can be here writing the morning line.
That's right, which you should subscribe,
subscribe
to. You can subscribe to it in multiple ways. Easiest way is at newshour.pbs.org. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Have a great night.